Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and thank you for coming today. Today's lecture recital is entitled Timbre Book, Study in Timbre in George Crumb's Madrigals Book 1. George Crumb's Madrigals Book 1 is not only a unique, wonderful chamber composition and aural experience, but also a prime example of his intelligent musical design and a milestone of his career. Throughout this piece, Crumb constructs by grouping similar timbres and inflections of different instruments together, while at the same time giving each instrument unique sounds. Madrigals Book 1 is the onset composition for George Crumb's style, which he would continue to use throughout the remainder of his career. George Crumb was born in Charleston, West Virginia on Black Thursday, the day that the Great Depression began, October 24th, 1929. His parents were both musicians that were heavily involved in the local music scene in Charleston. His father was a clarinetist and his mother was a cellist. Crumb's main instruments would be E-flat and the piano. He studied music first at the Mason College of Music in Charleston, West Virginia, where he received his bachelor's degree in 1950, where he studied with Eugene White. He obtained his master's degree at the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign, and then briefly studied in Berlin at the Hochschule für Musik, where he studied with Boris Blacher. This was before he returned to the United States and studied at the University of Michigan, from which he received his DMA in 1959, where he studied with Ross Lee Finney. Crumb has earned his living primarily from teaching. His first teaching job was at a college in Virginia called Hollins College, before he became the professor of piano and composition at the University of Colorado in 1958. In 1965, he began a long association with the University of Pennsylvania, becoming the Annenberg Professor of the Humanities in 1983. Crumb retired from teaching in 1997, though in early 2002 was appointed with David Burge to a joint residency at Arizona State University. He had many students throughout his career, most notably Christopher Rouse and Jennifer Higdon. American folk songs and a combination of styles from all over the world would heavily influence Crumb, as well as texts from Walt Whitman, Federico Garcia Lorca, and Sarasate. Crumb has been the recipient of many awards throughout his career, namely the Pulitzer Prize for Music in 1968 for his orchestral work Echoes of Time and the River, and a Grammy Award for Best Contemporary Composition in 2001 for his work Starchild. Black Angels and Ancient Voices of Children are two of his most well-known and critically acclaimed works, not only for their haunting atmospheres, but also their extensive sound palettes. Black Angels is scored for amplified string quartet, crystal glasses, and two suspended tam-tam gongs, and remains part of the chamber music canon through the Kronos Quartet. Ancient Voices of Children is scored for soprano, boy soprano, oboe, mandolin, harp, amplified piano, toy piano, and three percussionists playing a variety of instruments. Ancient Voices of Children was premiered at the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C. on October 31st, 1970, as part of the Coolidge Foundation's 14th Festival of Chamber Music. George Crumb notes his biggest influences as Gustav Mahler, Bela Bartok, Charles Ives, and Claude Debussy. In an interview with Edward Strickland, Crumb describes what allured him the most. Strickland asks, "With Mahler, or with Bartok or Debussy, was it essentially sonority that attracted you?" Crumb's response was, "No, that was just one element. Perhaps even more important was the way they introduced a new problem in their music. How to combine all kinds of music one wouldn't normally think of as belonging together. In Debussy, you have the French clavecin tradition, the music hall, the pop music of the time, even some jazz, Eastern music, Spanish influence, and even medieval organ. All this is somehow magically synthesized in a style of great power and personality. The same with Mahler and Charles Ives. Even Bartok, the way he combines so many systems, atonality, chromaticism, a relentless dissonance that's even more incisive than anything in the Viennese composers. Tonality, modality, whole tone configurations, and all of these things. Mahler's large use of percussion in his symphonies, particularly the 6th and 7th, influenced Crumb to use many various percussion instruments in his compositions. Mahler's specific imagery, tempi markings, are also what would influence Crumb with as well as elements of folk music. This is a score of Mahler's 6th symphony, and as you can see, there are many requirements for percussion in this piece. Two sets of timpani, bass drum with ruta, snare drum, cymbals, tam-tam, triangle, glockenspiel, xylophone, and two or more deep bells of intermittent pitch, cowbells, and the large box. Bartok was one of the best colorists in music, according to George Crumb. Not only was it his use of color that he admired, but many things that he then copied. Bela Bartok's sonata for two pianos and two percussion is emulated in Crumb's composition Macrocosmos 3, Music for a Summer Evening. Like Mahler, very specific instructions were given to tempi and even percussion instructions in regards to which beater to use. As we continue with Charles Ives, we see more evidence of the same characteristics that drew Crumb to the music of Mahler and Bartok. Extended use of percussion, and music that drew upon folk music and very specific instructions. Charles Ives' Life Pulse Prelude in his Universe Symphony could have displayed the huge world of percussion that was possible to any composer. However, the most interesting part of this piece is not the extensive percussion section, but that every percussionist is playing at a different tempo. Some performers were even asked to play at 67.5 BPM, a very specific tempo. This is a concept of musical autonomy that appears regularly in Crumb's music and even appears in the Rain Death Music 1 section of Madrigals Book 1. Aside from Bartok, Crumb seems to admire Debussy the most. Influences of specifics are just as apparent with Mahler, Bartok, and Ives, but his admiration seems to go further. Crumb has mentioned on several occasions how highly he regards Debussy and his composition Prelude to Afternoon of the Faun, and his exposed use of crotales, a technique that Crumb uses in many of his pieces, like Lux Aeterna. His admiration would go even farther when Crumb quoted Debussy's composition Syrinx for solo flute in his own piece, Idyll of the Misbegotten, for amplified flute and three percussions. The turning point in George Crumb's career comes in 1962. Madrigals Book 1 was composed in 1965 when George Crumb was 36 years old. Before 1962, Crumb considers his composition activities to fall into two categories of his, quote, representative works. The first, Juvenilia, which Crumb estimates he composed 40 to 50 pieces from 1939 to 1948, which consisted of numerous pieces for solo piano, a large number of chamber works, songs and choral pieces, and pieces for string orchestra and full orchestra. Most of these aforementioned composed after the classical and romantic models. consisted of more of the same styles. Crumb said, "I didn't find my way until 1962. A string quartet I wrote as a student in Ann Arbor was like recycled Bartok. The influence was immensely strong. That quartet could not be considered representative now, of course. I really didn't find my own way until 1962 after I finished school." In 1963, Crumb wrote Night Music 1, the first composition in which Crumb uses text from Federico Garcia Lorca. Crumb said, "I guess I felt that poetry demanded something in addition to normal bel canto singing. It was so intense at times, so intimate at times, it needed a much more primeval mode of singing." The vivid graphic text of Lorca sends Crumb down a path of necessity. If necessity is the mother of invention, then Crumb had to create a way to adequately set text musically, whether it be vocal text or the title of a piece. Madrigals Book 1 would become the proof of Crumb's turning point in his music by going farther than he ever had before in respects to timbre. In total, there are 37 distinct timbres between the three voices in this piece. We are focusing so heavily on this point in time because Crumb's music from this moment on is affected. Timbre, instrumentation, text, atmosphere, and many of the things that bring out Crumb's most defining characteristics come from this period. Before we continue any further, I believe it is important that we define and address the topic of timbre. Timbre, also known as tone color from psychoacoustics, is the character of a sound that distinguishes between different types of sound production, such as voice and musical instruments, string instruments, wind instruments, and percussion instruments. In simple terms, timbre is what makes a particular musical sound different from another, even when they have the same pitch and loudness. For instance, it is the difference between a guitar and a piano playing the same note at the same loudness. Experienced musicians are able to distinguish between different instruments based on their varied timbres, even if those instruments are playing notes at the same pitch and dynamic. Timbre can be thought of as being the result that an implement has on another object based on the characteristics of that implement. Weight, density, and material all can affect timbre and sound differently, granted that dynamics and velocity are even. The four books of the Madrigals were composed in pairs. Books 1 and 2 in 1965 were written for Jan de Gaetani on commission from the Koussevitzky Foundation, and books 3 and 4 in 1969 for Elizabeth Sudeberg. Like Night Music 1 and Ancient Voices of Children, they are based on the beautiful poetry of Federico Garcia Lorca. Each book is scored for soprano and two or more instruments, and the text consists from one to three short sentences, which dwell upon the themes of life, death, love, earth, water, and rain. The settings of the text are subtle, atmospheric, and intimate. Crumb does not strive for any large unison effects, but rather for a relatively large number of sonorous gradations within a small frame of reference. The choice of just a few accompanimental instruments, each with its own unique timbral and idiomatic characteristics, permits the composer to explore their interaction and contrapuntal combination with a meticulousness and a refinement that is disarming in its simplicity. What is particularly impressive about Book 1 is Crumb's creativity is giving each of the three parts, a soprano, a vibraphone, and a contrabass, a variety of characteristics throughout this piece. At this moment, I'd like to invite my friends Lisa and Amanda up to help me demonstrate some of the timbres in Book 1. few of the timbres throughout this piece. Seen in table two, this Soprano has the task of creating multiple timbres using her voice alone. As seen in table two, this has to be accomplished without the assistance of implements or meters, but by using vocal techniques and applications. The soprano part has six individual timbres. Spoken syllables, various spoken levels, and unvoiced syllables. Striking the body of the bass. And mal tremolos. Tables 4 through 6 catalog the applications and techniques of each part in Madrigals Book 1. However, the instruments are so drastically different that even similar inflections or timbres do not seem uniform, but instead have their own character. Table 4 shows the techniques, timbres, and applications of each part in Movement 1. To see you naked is to remember the earth. It is easy to see the correlation between the parts in this format. For example, the dead strokes of the vibraphone have a similar inflection to the phonetic syllables of the soprano part and the pizzicato parts of the contrabass part. Crumb has three parts performing secco inflections without ever writing a secco mark or asking the performers to play, quote, dry. He merely lets the timbres, techniques, and applications speak for themselves. Table 5 shows the techniques, timbres, and applications of each part in movement 2. They do not think of the rain, and they have fallen asleep. The timbre correlation in this movement occurs mainly between the vibraphone and the contrabass. The Rain Deaf Music 1 section of the movement shows the vibraphone and the contrabass playing two different timbres each at the same time. The vibraphone uses yarn mallets and a light triangle beater with full pedal down and vibrato, while the contrabass plays arco harmonics and pizzicato techniques. In this section, each part plays bright, sharp sounds and more warm, dark sounds at the same time, but still timbrely unique. The warm timbre created by the yarn mallets in the left hand of the vibraphone player is analogous to the dark timbre created by the left hand of the contrabass player performing the low pizzicato. Likewise, the sharp timbre created by the light triangle beater in the right hand of the vibraphone player is analogous to the bright timbre created by the arco harmonics of the contrabass. Speaking phonetic syllables at once adds to the congruency. in addition to the dry and articulate sounds for their respective instruments. Table 6 shows the techniques, timbres, and applications of each part in movement 3, the dead, wearer, mossy wings. In this movement, each part plays pitch bends, glissandi, and whispered text, as well as the implication of timbre applications that alter the conventional sound of each instrument. Each part performs pitch bends in different ways. The soprano and contrabass part alter their pitch and timbre with quarter tone bends, while the vibraphone plays half-step pitch bends. The pitch bends in the soprano tend to oscillate up and down and a quarter tone, while the contrabass part tends to descend a quarter tone. However, the pitch bends in the vibraphone part move in either direction by a half-step. This may be a compositional choice or simply the nature of the instruments, but nonetheless, each instrument is bending their pitch in their own unique way.
Thank you. Sing on, dormir.